Contents: A note on the book. Preface: Introduction. 1. Special instructions. 2. Repertory. 3. Yogic exercises, techniques, benefits, caution, etc. 4. Diet in disease. Glossary. Bibliography. Introduction. Hindu scriptures are invariably moksha shastras, treatises on the science of attainment of mental purity with its resultant liberation from the continuous cycle of birth and death and consequent misery. They are not based on logical intellectual gymnastics. They are founded on the experiences of supra scientific research men who have made exhaustive analysis and intense researches over life's problem in all aspects: physical, mental, intellectual, emotional, moral, and spiritual, and realized the truth. The records of their experiences are available in the Gita, Upanishads, Yoga, Vasishta, etc. According to them, the world that we experience from mind down to matter is only an aberration of reality. One will not have lasting peace and happiness so long as he is involved in it. Through irresistible attraction to its pleasures and vanities and consequent distraction and disappointment. Thus, it is a common experience that in spite of its glitter and allurements, worldly life is one of misery and regret. This is called samsara, the process of taking on and giving up the body. In order to bring about an end to this misery, or putting it positively, to attain eternal peace and happiness that passeth all understanding, which is the one very elusive quest of man. Elusive only because man's attention is diverted in the wrong direction. The ancient Sikhs have evolved systems of yogic practices suited to people of different temperaments. They are Jnanam Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga, Raja Yoga, etc. There are many misconceptions about yoga. A yogi is misunderstood to be a strange being with matted lock and unkempt beard, untidy in appearance, smeared with ashes, subsisting on herbs and roots, and living in some remote forest or in a dark cave in some distance inaccessible mountain range. Capacity to swallow glasses, drink nitric acid, ability to levitate by meditation, skill in predictions, knowledge of palmistry or astrology are not the real or main characteristics of a yogi. Magical performances such as rope tricks, mesmerism, physical aerobatics, exhibition of supernormal feat of endurance such as prolonged retention of breath when buried underground for several days by masterly control over breath, flying in air without the aid of wings, sitting on a bed of nails, or doing anything strange or extraordinary are not at all the purpose of yoga. None of these has anything to do with yoga. Such pernicious practices, which inflict pain on oneself as well as the onlookers, are resorted to attract the people and get name, fame and power. Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Shastram vihitam ghoram tapayante ye tapo jana dambhya hankara sayuktam kamaragam balan vitaha karshya yantah sharira stham bhuta grama mache tasam mama chaivantam sharira stham tamvi dhyastu rani sha yam. Chapter 17, Shlokas 5 and 6. Those men who practice terrific austerities not enjoyed by the scriptures are Hippocrates and egoists. They are full of strength, born of lust and extreme attachment. They have no intelligence or discrimination. They torture their body and mind and are far from God or the divine consciousness that is within. They are of Asuric demonic temperament. Yoga is not otherworldliness, it is inwardness. Yoga is not shirking one's duty, it is discipline and ceaseless performance of one's duty. Yoga is not running away from home, leaving human relations, it is cultivation of all embracing love. It is not a pessimistic approach to life, it is the most hopeful, optimistic approach to life. We see, we hear, we smell, we touch, we taste, we move about, we speak, we think. All these functions point to a fountainhead, a source that supplies the motive force for all activity, without which the organs, mind, intellect and all these become naught. Tameva bhanta manu bhati swaram tasya bhasa sarva midam vibhati katho panishad 2.2.15. It alone shines, everything else shine from its light. Everything here is revealed because of its light only. Behind the fleeting, fluctuating and changing objects that go to make the world, there is a reality, the constant, unchanging, immutable, absolute, supreme being, like the screen in the cinema on which the world picture appears and disappears. That divine being is the supreme truth, the transcendent reality, the infinite existence, knowledge, bliss beyond the reach of the senses and the mind. Yato vacho nivratante aprapyam manasa sahah taitariya apnaishad 2-2. From where all speech turns back, with the mind without reaching it, is the Brahman. The phenomenal world arises from this, subsists on it and dissolves in it. Yato va imani bhutani taittiriyopanishad 3-1. From where all these living beings have come forth, he in his infinite power projects the world and withdraws it into himself. Just as a bangle made of gold is not different from gold or a pot from the clay out of which it is made, or the waves from the ocean, even so the manifest world and the jiva is not different from the reality. The individual soul, being in fact a part and parcel of the infinite existence, is in its essential nature identical with the transcendent reality. The individual soul wells from the knowledge of its essential divinity and its consciousness limited by the encasing shells of matter. Ever seeks to overcome the limitations and sense of incompleteness. The theory and practice of yoga therefore is an answer to the most vital urge of man in his restless quest on the upward path of evolution, a constant reaching forth towards its primal abode of infinite, immortal, blissful existence. Viewed in a broad sense, any movement or any activity that consciously or unconsciously tends upwards and is evolutionary may be regarded as yoga. Everything that helps to disentangle man from the phenomenal world of sense objects is yoga. The word yoga comes from the Sanskrit root yuj, which means to join. Yoga is the science that teaches us the method of achieving unity of the individual soul with the supreme soul. The light, the intelligence which is behind the mind and intellect manifests only when the mind and the intellect are silenced. This intuitive wisdom is at the command of the yogi. The yogi knows how to relax, to silence the mind and intellect, to tap the inexhaustible source of intuitive wisdom through a systematic practice of focusing the mind and the intellect. The yogi is able to direct all the rays of mind and intellect inwards. Maharishi Patanjali says in his Yoga Sutras, Yoga Shitti Vritti Nirodha, Chapter 1, Sutra 2. Yoga is the suppression of the modification of the mind stuff or restraint of the thought wave or suppression of the tendency of the mind to transform itself into objects through thoughts. Tadham drastuha swarupam avasthanam, Chapter 1, Sutra 3. Then the seer rests of his own true nature. Once this technique is mastered, the yogi is able to remain in this state and carry on his work in the world with perfect efficiency. It makes available to him extraordinary physical, mental, intellectual, psychic, and spiritual power. He works but is not bound to the work. He serves but he does not expect a reward. He is efficient but he is not worried about success or failure, and is indifferent to honor or dishonor, pleasure or pain. In all conditions of life and at all moments of time, a yogi is always steady in mind. The mind has ceased to act and actions arise spontaneously. One who works thus for the welfare of all is perpetually in a state of inexpressible joy and peace that passeth all understandings. Wherever there is manifestation of a great power or achievement in science, in art, in literature, or in the management of men, it will be found that it is the yogi who is at work. This unfolding of the divine personality in man is not a merry fantasy or a poet's imagination, but a positive truth which has been realized in their lives by the greatest of saints, sages, seers, and saviors all over the world. This is capable of being achieved by man here and now. This is the unique panacea for all the ills of the world and of humanity in this age of satellites and space travel. Any other endeavor connected with the material plane alone, such as democracy, capitalism, socialism, and communism, will not bring real and everlasting space to mankind. This is the message which our ancient rishis and prophets have been giving to the world from time immemorial. There are various schools of yoga suited to people of different mental and physical makeup, so that each may choose one according to his capacity, need, or requirement, and evolve higher and higher. The different paths are complementary to each other, each in harmony with the other, and each leading to the other. Hatha Yoga develops, controls, and strengthens the physical body to render it a more fitting instrument for the realization of the higher self. Karma Yoga is selfless service of humanity, is render the mind purer. Raja Yoga deal with the mind, its control, development, and unfolding. Bhakti Yoga deals with the love of the Absolute One God. It puts an end to the tossing of the mind and helps to attain God consciousness through devotion. Jnana Yoga deals with the scientific and intellectual investigation into the fundamental principles and wonderful truth underlying life. It develops the will and reason that brings about the knowledge of the self. The aspirant may betake himself to any path which suits him, not necessarily confining himself to one path. In short, it is a process of eliminating the dross out of the ego and reducing it to a state of purity, similar to the seer, the Purusha, who is ever free and liberated, thus neutralizing the impulse for further birth. When this is done, the fetters that bound the soul are broken. There is no more fear, no more grief. Tatra ko mohah ko shokah. Ishava shopanishad. 7. How can there be any delusion or grief? In Yoga Vasishta, sage Vasishta says, Abhavanena bhavanam viloya karma kananam parama samitya tanavam vishoka eva tishta boh. Having dissolved all thoughts, the cause for creation of the endless cycle of actions, the one being the resultant of the other and vice versa, by non-thinking attain the supreme lightness and joy of awareness, remain thus utterly free from all misery and conflict. To be continued. Like and subscribe.